بسم الله بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على الرحمة المهداة محمد بن عبد الله. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Brothers and sisters, I assume there are sisters. Okay. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
And Ramadan Mubarak inshallah upon each and every one of us and upon the ummah inshallah. The topic, the Quran and the Sahaba, or how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum related to the Quran, I feel on one hand it's quite a risky and dangerous topic, and I'll tell you why later on, inshallah. Because it will put a great burden on us. That's why. We will see why, inshallah. We will see exactly why. So it's a very dangerous topic, and you've asked for it, so I don't know if you're prepared to handle the consequence of it. And to really understand the importance of what I'm saying, I think we need to understand also the situation of the Sahaba before they became Sahaba, before Islam. How was Arabia at that time? How were they, the companions that we speak of, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhum ajma'in, how were they before Islam? How was the situation before Islam? And I think if you wanted to really go in depth in how the state of Arabia at that time, of the companions before Islam, there's a very great book by Abin Hassan Ali Nadawi radiallahu anhu. Abin Hassan Ali Nadawi, I think he's from Dioband. He has written a great book called Mada Khasra Al-Alam Bil-Hitat Al-Muslimin, what the world has lost by the downfall of the Muslims. And the introduction of it talks about how they were. And in reality, they were divided. They were fighting amongst each other. Tribes were, you know, fighting. In some cases, for example, Harb al-Basus, about a camel, a she camel, a war lasted for 30 years, just because of a she camel. They used to commit all sorts of fusq, okay? They lied, they cheated, there was a lot of injustice. I think maybe one of the best hadiths on this, if I can find my spectacles, here they are. For example, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, and you should know this because Ja'far ibn Abi Talib said this when he was in Abyssinia, in speaking to the Najashi. Describing how they were before Muhammad came, and he said, "Kunna qawman ahl jahiliyyah." We are a people who were living in ignorance. نعبد الأصنام ونأكل الميتة. We used to worship idols. Imagine, you know, people really worshiping idols. What do you think of them? And we eat الميتة or the dead. Anything that's dead, we will eat it. وَنَأْتِي الْفَوَاحِشِ, and we commit atrocities, and we do not, we are not faithful to our kin, نَقْطَعَ الْأَرْحَامِ, and we are very bad neighbors, and the strong amongst us oppress the weak. That's how they were. What changed? What turned darkness into light? What turned weakness into strength? what turned chaos, that's what their life was, chaos, into organization. What made them a superpower when they were ignorant, when Abraha, for example, Abraha decided to go and destroy Al-Kaaba. There was no resistance whatsoever. No one stopped in his way. He moved from Al-Yemen to Mecca. No one stopped him because they were divided. And suddenly, the same people come and liberate Abyssinia and liberate Persia, the greatest power, and liberate the rest of what is known today as the Arab world. What was the difference? And the answer, of course, is the Quran. That's the difference. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Islam, and even the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a manifestation of the Quran. That's what it is, an interpretation of the Quran. Okay, if that is the case, if the Quran changed their life in such an incredible way, okay, they didn't have the Quran, they were not Muslims, they became Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to them, they changed the world. We have the Quran. We are Muslims. Why aren't we changing the Quran? The world, sorry. Why? What's the difference between them, the companions, and us? Someone might say, they are the companions. They are humans, like us. Don't think the companions were super beings. The companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, were human beings like us. So whatever works for them can work for us. So what's the difference? I am sure that the companions today, if they came and saw our life now, they, on one hand, they would be envious. Why? Because I am sure that each one of us has at least 10 copies of the Quran in his home. Maybe even a translation into some languages. We have computers and laptops and iPhones, and we can access the Quran wherever we are. Okay? And we can even access the meaning of the Quran. Okay? In that sense, they were envious. We have access to all Islamic knowledge at the tip of our fingers. But I'm sure they will be very crossed with us, on the other hand. Why? Because even though we have access to the Quran and its meaning, we can read it, and we have interpretation, and we have Qari, and we have Hafid, yet we do not implement the Quran, and this is the difference. And today, brothers, if this message reaches, then this is my talk. This is the essence of it. That the companions, how they related to the Quran or with the Quran, they implemented it. While we have it with us, we do not implement the Quran. Is this my interpretation, my understanding of the situation, my personal one, or is it more than that? No, it's more than that. Actually, Ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu, he has a very famous hadith. He says, "Inna su'iba alayna hifzi alfad al-Qur'an." To memorize the words of the Qur'an was made difficult for us. The companions had difficulties in memorizing the Qur'an. Don't think that they memorized the Qur'an. Yes, some of them did, but not all of them. Okay? It was made Ibn Mas'ud, Tarjaman al-Qur'an, the interpreter of the Qur'an, this is his nickname given by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, "Inna su'iba alayna hifd al-fad al-Qur'an." It was made difficult by whom? By Allah. was made difficult for us to memorize the words of the Quran, but it was made easy for us to implement it. Other people who will come after us will find it easy to memorize the Quran, but difficult to implement it. This is Ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu. There are many meanings of this, and therefore you will find great problem. Okay. For example, even though it's not a hadith, but it is narrated by Tirmidhi, for example, through Mus'ab, that وَكَمْ مِنْ مَا آمَنَ بِالْقُرْآنِ مِنْ اسْتَحَلَّ مَحَارَمًا. For example, this is a famous saying. Some people say it's a hadith, but it's not certain whether it is a hadith. But what it means is that he who does things that are haram in the Quran does not believe in it. وَكَمْ مِنْ قَالٍ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَالْقُرْآنُ يَلْعَنَهُ. Many people who recite the Quran, okay, when the Quran damns them. For example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when someone reads that something against al-munafiqi, and he is munafiq, or those who lie when he himself lies. There are many verses in the Quran like this. You read the verse, okay, and it applies to you. And it damns you because you're reading it. Where do you go from this? This is a serious problem. Okay? The problem of implementation. And therefore you'll find that the companions have made great effort, one effort. One famous saying by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Okay? And Umar ibn al-Khattab relates incredibly with the Quran. He says that we used to take only seven verses from the Quran. Seven verses only. Okay? We would memorize them and then understand them. What do they mean? Today, a lot of people who recite the Quran, even Arabs who speak Arabic. It's not got nothing to do with whether you understand Arabic or not. A lot of Arabs don't know what the Quran means. Okay. It's easier for them, definitely, but at the same time, their life, it is such that they don't really understand. They need an interpretation. They need to read an explanation of the Quran. Okay? And so Umar ibn Khattab, he says, we memorize it, the seven verses. We then understand what it means, and then we implement it. And then we move on to the next seven. And because of this, it took Umar ibn Khattab 12 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. 12 years. Don't tell me he's not keen. He is keen. Okay, he is committed. He wants to memorize. And he reads the Quran every night. But he does not read for the sake of reading. He does not memorize for the sake of memorization. He reads and memorizes for the sake of understanding and implementing. Okay? And without the implementation, then you are reading words that have no meaning in reality. Let me give you an example. For example, that the Quran is Shifa and Huda, and it's a guidance, it's a cure, it's this, it's that. Imagine that you have a sickness, okay? And you go to the doctor. And the doctor gives you a prescription and he tells you, this will sure cure you. This prescription here, this medicine I'm prescribing, will definitely cure the sickness that you have. So you go home and you look at it and you start reciting the words on the prescription. recite it 1,000,000 times. It's not going to cure you. Okay? Recite it in secret. Recite it out loud. Recite it with ahkam. It's still not going to cure you. It's only going to cure you when you take that prescription and turn it into a medicine and then take that medicine. Start to implement. If you have a skin disease and you're told, you know, your cure is to expose yourself to the sun. And one day there's a sunny day and you sit in the shade, huh? And you say, what a beautiful sunny day. Great sun, look at the sun. Is it going to cure your disease? It's not, unless you expose yourself to the disease. How, what do I mean by implementing? Don't think it's difficult, that it's easy. It's not easy, okay? For example, in our society, take the committed, those who come to pray in the mosque. Are they implementing Islam? A test, a small test. MashaAllah, someone who comes to the mosque, and, but when someone comes to him from not his tribe or not from his country and asks for the hand of his daughter, he doesn't give her to him. Is he implementing the Quran? Is this guy implementing the Quran? No, of course he isn't. He reads the Quran, but he does not live the Quran. And therefore, living the Quran is very important. When some people came to Aisha radiallahu anha, and they asked her, what was the conduct of the Prophet? How was he? And she said, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. His conduct was the Quran. He is a practical manifestation of the Quran. That's what he is. Okay? Sayyid Qutb radiallahu anhu. Sayyid Qutb radiallahu anhu. He used to describe the generation of the Sahaba as a unique Quranic generation. They lived by the Quran and with the Quran. That's how they were. They did not just sort of made theories and spoke and you know, mashallah, they can quote the Quran, but when you look at their life and how they lived their life, they were not really implementing the Quran. But the companions, that's their day then. That's how they lived their life, by implementing the Quran. And one of their commitment to the Quran is that they, and I'm going to be quite careful in this, they did not take their ideology, okay? They did not take their ideology from anywhere else. This is also an important point. They did not need to take their ideology, their aqidah, their understanding, their moral frame of reference from anywhere else. Today, many of us seek external frame of references and think of it as necessary. And we need it, especially from the West. Okay? Values that are not Islamic are being adopted by the Muslims. While the companion, they weren't like that. When Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was dying, he was sick in bed, he knew that it's his time. Aisha, his daughter, the wife of the Prophet of the Mu'mineen radiallahu anhu, she quoted some poetry. The poetry is something like when the sickness of death is upon you, then nothing will keep your life from coming out. And he looked at her very angrily. She quoted a poet, famous poet from the Jahiliyyah period. Okay? And he was very angry with her, and he said to her, "No, O mother of the faithful." La ya umm al-mu'minin. He called her with her title. ولكن let me just وجاءت سكرة الموت بالحق ذلك ما كنت منه تحيد. He quoted the Quran. Why? It may be the same meaning. But no, our reference is the Quran. It's not a poet from Al-Jahiliyyah. Okay? We don't need to refer to, for, especially for our values and our morals and our aqidah and our faith to anything other than what is in Islam. For our life, yes. Don't tell me you don't study mathematics or physics or, you know, and gain those knowledge from outside, yes. But for our frame of reference, especially in matters of value and morality and understanding of the nature of the universe and this and that, we take it from Al-Quran. The Sunnah and from nothing else. They were committed to the Quran. Ibn Mas'ud, he says, by Allah, there is no verse in the Quran except I know for whom it was revealed or the story behind it, who was it revealed about, and where it was revealed and when. And if I knew that there is someone who is more knowledgeable about the Quran than me, who could be reached, then I will do my utmost to go to him and to study at his hand. Anyone who understands the Quran and implements it and knows how to explain it, they would seek him out. And therefore, the companions of Ridwanullahi alayhim used to respect highly those who memorize the Quran. Because, as I said, it's not just memorizing, okay? It's implementing. So it is linked, okay? The more you memorize, the more you implement. And Salim, one companion called Salim, he was in Hurub al-Ridda after the Prophet, when many people went out of Islam, and there was fighting, he was given the banner of Islam, of the army. And he said to himself, woe to me, and to my memorization of the Quran, if I don't stand up this day. What's the point of me memorizing the Quran if I don't, you know, show myself, my true self, because of this Quran that I carry with me? Okay? And therefore, his hand, his right hand was cut. So he held the banner with his left hand. His left hand was cut. So he held the banner with whatever remained from his hands. And so on and so forth. You'll find many stories like this amongst the companion radiallahu anhu, that proves that the most important thing to them is the implementation of the Quran. They used to love the implementation of the Quran and the recitation. And therefore, when Abu Bakr Siddiq once came to Umar ibn Khattab, and he said to Umar, let's go and visit Ayman, just like the Prophet used to visit her. This was after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So both of them went to Ayman to visit her, just like the Prophet used to visit her. And when they were talking, she started to cry. And they said to her, you know, Ayman, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in a better place. In a better place than this. You don't need to cry for the Prophet. And she said to them, do you think that I don't know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in a better place than this? I know that, and I'm not crying about that. I'm crying because there's no more revelation. There is no more Quran. That the revelation between the heavens and the earth, between Allah and us, is over. Is over. It is possible. It is possible, okay, that the Quran and the way the companions related to it was because the Quran was above the companions. It's not like a book that is in a shelf and they, you know, sort of, they took it and they started reading it. It's not about some other people, some other stories. It actually related to their life. Okay? When the Quran speaks about Ghazwat Badr, they have just come from Ghazwat Badr. When it speaks about Ghazwat Al-Ahzab, they have just come out of Ghazwat Al-Ahzab. When it speaks about Hadith Al-Ifk, they are just living it. They're still living it. Okay? So it is a book that spoke about their life as it happens. And that's the way I would like the Quran to be taught to us today. Okay? Not just as a course in some academia, no, but as a reference book that tells us about what is happening to us now as it happens. And this needs scholars who understand, who can relate to what is happening to our life and the Quran. And the Quran. And therefore you will find that the companions were very keen to follow the revelation. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he says that, of course, Umar ibn Khattab and the companions, they had their lives, like us. Don't imagine that they were just sitting in the mosque, you know, with the Prophet 24/7. They had their life, they had their businesses, they had to take care of their businesses, they had property, they had land. They had a life, just like us, okay? And therefore, they could not be with the Prophet 24/7. So what did they do? Umar ibn Khattab had an arrangement with one of the companions. He did not name him. He said, I had an arrangement with one Ansari, from the Ansari. And the arrangement is that one day, Umar ibn Khattab goes and stays with the Prophet. And the other day, the Ansari goes and stays with the Prophet. And at night, they would meet to tell each other what has happened. Okay? So they were on top of things. They understood whether something has been revealed or it hasn't been revealed. When has it been revealed? And they responded to the Quran immediately. And they responded to the Prophet immediately. For example, Hadith al-Ifk. I don't know if you know Hadith al-Ifk or not. What I mean by the slandering of Aisha radiallahu anha. When Aisha radiallahu anha was slandered, one of those people who picked up on the slander was a companion who was who received help and financial support from Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Okay? Listen to this story. This companion, he receives charity from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And then he goes and participates in the slandering of Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who gives him charity. What do you think Abu Bakr as-Siddiq felt? Radiallahu anhu. Of course he didn't like it. And he said that he will cut the charity on this poor companion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals in the Quran not to do that. Abu Bakr responds immediately and continues to give charity to this poor man. And this is a human thing. You have to beware. Those that you sometimes help may not like it. Human nature. You give them charity, you help them out, don't expect that they will, you know, forever be indebted to you. They may even go against you. Okay? Why? Because this is the nature of things. Except the faithful, except the real, pure human beings, the good quality. إذا أكرمت الكريمة ملكته وإذا أكرمت اللئيمة تمرد. If you are generous to a generous man, you own him. But if you are generous to a spiteful man, then he will go against you. This companion slandered or participated in the slandering of Aisha radiallahu anha. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq wanted to cut off the charity and the help that he used to give him. Allah ordered him not to through the Quran. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq responded immediately. And when it comes to the response of the companion, now I said that the hadith of the Prophet and the relation with the Prophet is is an immediate product of the Quran. Okay? It's not just the Quran, because if it was just the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have sent the Quran down with an angel. Some angels could have come, here is your book, go and study it, and no, it wasn't like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad and sent the Quran, so that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam implements the Quran in a practical way. This is how Muslims should live. This is how they relate. If you want to know how to implement the Quran, look at the Sunnah of the Prophet. Look at the story of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's a real manifestation of the Quran. And then the companions. And then the companions. And therefore, one day, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu comes to the Prophet. And he says to him, O Messenger of Allah, you are dearer to me than everyone except myself. I love myself more than I love you, Messenger of Allah. That's what he's saying. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "La ya Umar, no, Umar, no. والذي نفسه بيدي, by he who has his soul in my hand, you shall not believe until I am dearer to you than even yourself. You shall not believe until I am dearer to you than even yourself. A change of understanding. A change of feeling, a change of perspective. any human being today, if you ask him to do that, at least he will tell you, give me some time to think. You can't expect me to do it right now. You want me to change my understanding of things. You want me to change my perspective. You want to give me some time, not Omar. Omar immediately he says, "An ana ya Rasulullah, now, O Messenger of Allah." Meaning, now you're dearer to me than even myself. The Prophet says, "Now, ya Omar, al ana ya Omar." Meaning, now your faith is complete. Omar tells us why. Why, ya Omar? Why did you? You didn't even ask for time to think. He says, "I looked, and I found that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is more important to me for my own safety on the day of judgment and my success than my own nafs. Who do I need on the day of judgment? Do I need the Prophet more or do I need myself more? I need the Prophet more. He's dearer to me than my nafs." And that's the teaching of the Quran. It's not, as I said, it's not easy. And when they are reminded of the Quran, they stop. Umar ibn Khattab, when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, came out with his sword. And he said, "Anywhere, anyone who says the Prophet is dead, I will chop his head off." Abu Bakr al-Siddiq told him a verse from the Quran, "وَمَا مُحَمَّدٍ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ." And it is as though Umar ibn Khattab came out of a trance. And he says, "By God, it's as if though this is the first time I hear this verse." He knows the verse. Okay? But the implication and the meaning of it is strong with them, how they relate and how they link with these verses is really exceptional. Really exceptional. And therefore they were able to have an understanding of life and its meaning that is incredible. You know, I told you the story of one of the companions who went to see Rustam, the general of the Persian army. His name is Rab'i ibn Amr. Remember? No? I'm sure you will remember when I tell you the story. Rab'i ibn Amr, I haven't come across this companion except on this occasion. He's not of the caliber of Abu Bakr or Umar. And this is significant, because if he was of the caliber of Abu Bakr and Umar, we might argue, well, they are Abu Bakr and Umar. But this is a normal companion. There are thousands of them. In the farewell ceremony, there were 12,000 companions who attended the farewell ceremony of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are thousands of companions. Okay, he's one of them. Okay, and when he went to meet Rustam, the general, the Persian general wanted to find out what brought this Muslim army suddenly. You know, Arabia is insignificant and important. Suddenly, a great army is at the frontiers of Persia, about to take over Persia. Who are these people? What do they want? What motivates them? Rustam wanted to find out, who are they? So he requested a delegation to meet with him. The general of the army appointed Rab'i ibn Amr as head of the delegation. So Rab'i ibn Amr, the companion, the man who was in Jahiliyyah just a few years ago, okay, suddenly is going to meet Rustam general of the Persian Empire. And he went. And Rustam asked him, what brought you Arabs out of the desert? What is it? You want money? You want glory? Why? And he simply said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said this. Allah. I say to myself, why did he say that? Why did he say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us? Is he claiming that he receives revelation? The army, the Muslim army, was during the reign of Abu Bakr, not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore, this soldier today would have said, Abu Bakr, Umar has sent us. Or he might even say, well, you know something, I was appointed by the general of the Muslim army to come and meet you. But he's saying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us. So he understands that his mission, that his presence in the army, that him being at the head of a delegation is a mission from Allah. And therefore today, if you're asked, if you someone meets you in the street or at the university or college or at your work, you know, none here look like their goras. All Pakistanis, I think. Okay. Someone asks you, what are you doing in my country? What are you doing here? What brought you to Rochdale? What would you say? What would you answer? You know, my father came from Pakistan, you know, looking for a better life, and I came with him. Or I came as a refugee, and you know, or I married an English woman and I remained. Or I came to study and then I remained. Who would say, God has sent us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us. You see the understanding? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us. My life is around Allah. Whatever I do is around Allah. All my commitment, my orders are from the Quran. You want your order in life? Read the Quran. Find out. What are you about? How do I know this? Because the Prophet ﷺ says that there shall not be a house made of brick or made of cloth except that Islam will enter it. Your homes, all this area, it wasn't built by Muslims. It was built by non-Muslims. Now you have, mashallah, owned a lot of property around this area and you're living in it. Isn't that a manifestation of the prophecy of the Prophet? How will Islam enter? Us, through the Muslims. So we are the ambassadors of Islam. We are the ambassadors of the Quran. Okay? And therefore it is very important, and that's why it's very dangerous. Because before today we may say we don't know. But today, how can you say after today I don't know? You can't. You have to implement the Quran. If given a choice between memorizing the Quran and implementing the Quran, or a choice between understanding the Quran and implementing the Quran, even though I don't see how you could implement without understanding. Okay? Might be very difficult to implement without understanding. I would rather the implementation is something that you adopt. Yahi, don't memorize the Quran, but implement it. Implement the Quran. Live the Quran. Let your life rotate and revolve around the Quran. Islam, because that's what the Quran is. And if you don't do that, then, and therefore, the understanding of life, the understanding of life itself comes from the Quran. How a Muslim should live his life. And let me continue with the Rabi'i ibn Amr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us to do what? لنخرج العباد من عبادة العباد إلى عبادة رب العباد. To liberate mankind. We have the mission of liberating mankind. We should liberate the people around us from being subservient to man to being subservient to Allah alone. Where does this understanding come from? It's from the Quran. Rabi'i ibn Amr, a simple companion, not Abu Bakr and Umar. You see how the companions understood the mission and the message of the Quran? They wouldn't sleep. They worked very hard. Why do you think they're buried across the Muslim world? What? Recently, I went to visit the grave of Abi Ayyub al-Ansari. What was he doing in Istanbul? When I read that a prayer in Al-Haram Sharif is 100 times in worth than any other mosque, or the 1,000 times.
100,000.
And a prayer in the mosque of the Prophet is 1,000 times. And a prayer in Al-Aqsa is 500 times more than any other mosque. Allahu Akbar. Would you leave Al-Haram Sharif or the Medina? If you had the chance to live in Medina, I know a lot of people, if they had the chance to live in the Medina, they would go and live in Medina. The companions were living there. What were they doing being buried outside Arabia altogether? The last companion alive, I think he's buried in Spain. I know he crossed to Spain, because one of the ports is named after him. The last companion alive, 93 years after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hijra. So, some companions are buried in Libya. One of the great battles that took place in our region was known as the Battle of the Seven Abdullah. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr, Seven Abdullah. What were they doing? They were spreading the word of Islam. Why? Because it's greater in value than praying in Al-Haram Sharif. Allahu Akbar. Because it's greater in value than being close to the Prophet in Medina. That's why. And here we are, we have the opportunity to spread Islam. Okay? And this great ashur. Are we doing it? We're not. Why? Because we don't know. We don't understand. We don't really comprehend the message of the Quran to liberate mankind from being subservient to man to being subservient to Allah alone. And from 5 minutes, okay. And from the hardship of this life and from the injustice of other religions to the justice of Islam. Bear in mind that here the word used is justice. From the injustice of other religions to the justice of Islam. Okay. In the West, the dominant value is not justice. The dominant value is equality. Okay. The dominant value is equality. And therefore, when I start thinking on those lines, when my wife, who's a teacher in an Islamic school, and there are a lot of non-Muslims teaching at this school as well. And now in Ramadan, there was an argument that Muslim teachers should not be given duties because it undermines the whole concept of shortening the school hours during Ramadan. Okay? But the head teacher, she said, if I said that only non-Muslims would be given duties, then it would be racist. Why? Because we're all equal, Muslims and non-Muslims are equal. Okay? Why? Because the dominant value is equality in this country. It's not justice. A man and a woman are equal. You can't say, no, this woman should have this, woman, men. You can't say that. But if the dominant value is justice, okay, then it becomes totally different. And therefore, the main value, what Rabi'i ibn Amr says, from the injustice of other religions to the justice of Islam. And therefore, people in the West, they will not understand this. During the empire of I don't know if that's the right word, of the Ottoman Empire, okay, I came across this in Bosnia. The Ottoman Empire made a decree that Muslims should wear certain dress, Muslim men and women, they must wear certain dress. Christians should wear another color, and Jews should wear a third color. In the values of today, this is discrimination. Absolute discrimination. Okay? And remember when I spoke about taking our values from other than the Quran, I know that a lot of Muslims will see it like this, discrimination. But if we asked why, then it's different. Why? Because if someone wearing a Christian clothes, he's a Christian, okay, and we find him drinking in Ramadan, then that's okay because he's a Christian. Or he is drunk, then we won't take him and flog him, put him in prison. Why? Because he's Christian and in his religion he's allowed to drink. Okay? If he eat pork or why? Because he has his own set of rule, because that's justice. It's not equal, but it's justice. Okay? Where does this come? This comes from our understanding of Islam and implementing it. And lastly, when Rabi'i ibn Amr, he says, and from the hardship of this life to the abundance of this life and the hereafter. Okay? So the understanding, I wish I could, you know, spend some more on this. The understanding from the Quran, the companions from the Quran, is that it is not just about the hereafter. Many people think that if you're a Muslim, then khalas, you have nothing to do with life, you have nothing to do with the hustle and bustle of life, with, you know, you read the Quran and you pray and you spend your time in the mosque. You've got nothing to do with life, you've got nothing to do with politics, you've got nothing to do with society. No, you're a man of the hereafter. From the hardship and difficulty of this life to the abundance of this life and the hereafter. That's the understanding of the companion. I'll end up with this story. Talha ibn Ubaidillah, a great companion, he once comes to the Prophet, comes to Abu Bakr, and he says, "Oh Abu Bakr, nafaqa Talha. Oh Abu Bakr, Talha is a hypocrite. Abu Bakr knows Tanhani, he knows that he's not a hypocrite, he knows that he's a great companion. And so he asked him, how so, Talha, how are you a hypocrite? He said, when we are with the Prophet, when we are sitting with the Prophet, we are charged spiritually and emotionally. And we become so transparent and so full of spirituality. But when we leave the Prophet, when we go about our business and our children and our property and our land and the hustle and bustle of life, we lose a lot of that. We lose a lot of that. Abu Bakr reflected for a while and said to him, by Allah, I am like you, I'm the same. From their understanding, they saw that this is a sign of hypocrisy. And then they go to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the importance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is he explains the Quran to the companion. And therefore we cannot have the Quran without the companion. That's why when you read, for example, small surahs, you say قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Why قُلْ? It's Muhammad. Oh Muhammad, say. That's originally how it is. Oh Muhammad, say قُلْ. We still say قُلْ. We don't throw away قُلْ. Why? Because to link Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Quran, to Allah. That we understand the Quran and we take it and we implement it through the explanation and the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they decide to go to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Talha again, he says, Nafaqa, Talha ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, Talha is a hypocrite. How so? So Talha explains to him, and the Prophet smiles, and he says, by Allah, if you continue to be in the state in which you're in, when you're with me, then the angels will shake your hands in the street. Not possible. I.e., you will exceed the angels in their spirituality. And we're not angels, nor are we animals. And therefore, a very beautiful statement. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Walakin Talha sa'atan wa sa'a." But O Talha, an hour. I.e., there's time for spirituality and ibadah. Then there's time for the hustle and bustle of life, as Salman al-Farisi says. "Walakin." لِرَبِّكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا وَلِنَفْسِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا وَلِأَهْلِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا. Allah has a right over you. You, your body and your soul, have a right over yourself and your intellect. Okay? And your family has a right over you. So give each one who has a right on you their right. Therefore, the companions were masters of the world of life. They engaged in life. They did not just keep Islam in the mosque. Islam to them was life. There's no such thing as political Islam or spiritual Islam. No, Islam is comprehensive. We're not, but Islam is complete. That's the understanding of Islam. That's how the companions implemented the Quran. That's how we should follow suit. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم من سائر المسلمين.